we're almost done. We've got one more single summon, and then it's up to you guys or my work to give me a massive bonus to get anything else.
And with that...
Nope, wrong banner. Yes, let's go. This banner. Go. Be purple. Thank you. Be Sackbo. Thank you. We're done. It's over. I just had to be stern with it. We're done. Oh. We're there, boys. We got him. We got him. Oh boy, we got him. Hi everyone, Cleefull here. First, I want to sort of apologize for how long it's taken me to get this video out. It, in truth, should have been out Thursday last week, but the recent lockdown has me classified as an essential employee, whereas about 70 to 80% of my coworkers are not. As such, I'm doing both mine and their work, so my work hours have grown from 20 hours to about however much is needed to get everything done. Last week was 52 hours, and the time spent not working, I was basically a Reaper husk. However, we are here now, and I'm working on changing my workflow to enhance my flexibility on how I can work on these videos to better utilize what time I do have. So look forward to a more consistent upload schedule, just it might take a week or two to get back into the swing of things. Now that's enough about me, we should get into the video and talk about the combos that Xiao has, and further explain where the difficulty in his execution of these combos comes from. But before we get started, I want to make a brief synopsis on Xiao and give my immediate week 1 thoughts and observations, and make a response to my previous video. Xiao by no means is a weak character, and I never intended to sell him as such with my previous video. Xiao by himself is the second highest DPS character we currently have in the game, without reactions taken into account of course. With reactions and real world expectations on how close to frame perfect you can get his high plunge combos to be, he finds himself in the fourth place amongst the top DPS characters. He does, however, have a couple of strong points that does put him potentially above Diluc and Klee in actual play. These are the fact that his plunge spam has a frankly ridiculous stagger modifier, and a larger than normal AoE radius, allowing him to both provide a large room clearing potential and bypass Hilichurl and Mitochurl shields. In the current Abyss stages, when able to ignore or fix his team energy hunger, he is either the first or second best pivot pick for these floors due to the AoE, stagger, and shield bypass characteristics he has. All in all, he is an incredibly capable unit. Just when I made the previous video, I did so with the immediate goal of providing information to people who are thinking of possibly pulling him, who might not know the full picture behind him. Moving over to what we all came here for, it's time to cover the different combos that Xiao has. By combo, I am specifically referencing a singular chain or attack progression throughout his available moves. We in the Genshin Impact theorycrafting community generally denote these combos by a series of letters and numbers to quickly get the combo path across. As such, a brief description of what all the letters are used for is important. The main letters used are as follows. N is for normal. You may find them followed by a number like N1 or N3, normal 1 and normal 3 respectively. Essentially what this means is you will do your normal attacks until you execute the normal attack of that number. C is for charged attacks, which is quite simple. You might see this prefaced with an N plus number, such as N1C. This just means you execute your N1 and then execute the charged attack. E is for one's elemental skill. Q is for one's elemental burst. J is for jump, P is for plunge, and D is for dash. Using this information, you should be able to somewhat grasp what I mean when I say, for instance, N2C EQ. This denotes using the first two normal attacks, followed by your charge attack, and then a skill and burst. These strings are made to either denote the best combos that are easy to frame perfect together, such as normal strings, aka N6, or charges, such as N1C. Or they are used to denote strings that let you frame cancel earlier moves, improving your overall DPS and survivability by taking less time to execute these actions. So, now that we know what the letters mean, what are Xiao's combos? Well, he's got a few different combo paths that all have their individual use cases and value. These combos are as follows. He has his N6, N1C, N3C, N1CE and its N3 variant, JEP, JEEP, Plunge Spam, N1/2JP, and N1CJP. These combos can generally be categorized into out-of-burst and in-burst combos, though some of them are transferable between the two categories. Remember, these are only single combo strings, and they don't individually stop you from executing a string of these combos, such as going from N1CE to JEEP if you happen to have C1, though the utility of that particular string is minimal at best, but it does get my point across. I'm now going to rapid fire what each combo is best at, so I can get most of the combos out of the way and get into where most of Xiao's mechanical difficulty comes in, because it's not with the general combo frame cancels, though those are also important. If you're using his normal string, N6 is the highest DPS if you dash or jump cancel after the initial hit. This is followed by his N5, and then N3. Note, using the first half of normal 1 to precede any other action or combo that does not contain a normal is generally a DPS increase due to how few frames it requires to execute, if it happens to hit something. N1C is the most common normal to charge cancel, as it's impossible to not frame perfect the execution of it on sword and spear users, only needing to hold the attack button down to execute. Still, you do need some skill to string multiple of them together in a row with good frame counts. N3C is the superior charge attack option, having the highest DPS of all the normal to charge attack variants. It does require a small amount of mechanical skill to string together properly, but is quite easy to execute frame perfectly. This is also better for on-normal effects, such as C6 Fischl and Jingchou ult. You have a 9-frame grace where this does more DPS than N1C at frame-perfect N1C, and more when not. It's also, in my opinion, cooler, but it is a bit harder to execute. Frame-perfect to frame-perfect, this is approximately a 6% DPS increase compared to normal 1 charge. This is the highest consistent DPS out of any normal or normal plus charge strings. N1CE and N3CE are both out of vault finishers. They're useful for when your E would deal the final blow on an enemy, letting you rocket in a direction towards the next target, or through a line of enemies for a nice batch of AoE damage. N1C has better DPS than N3C, but the latter has a higher total damage output, making it the more useful ender. Both do more DPS than N3C, but you are limited by your E cooldowns and charges, so it is not fully spammable. JEP is an amazing engagement tool. It lets you lunge into a group of enemies and finish with a plunge. There is massive burst DPS capabilities here, but the fixed distance of Xiao's E makes execution limited to engaging groups of enemies from outside with a distance. JEEP is a stronger version of JEP, but requires 2 E uses and is only really usable when you're already in melee combat. It has some issues in large groups, taking you back to where you initially leapt from, so it's not foolproof. However, it is his highest burst DPS of any combo outside of ult, period. Using it when in ult is not recommended though, due to both the tight execution window of how fast and how high he jumps, and wasting e-casts when you could have been saving them to use them outside a vault to generate energy. And then we have his three plunge options, Plunge Spam, N-half JP, and N1C JP. Plunge Spam is just jumping, then plunging. Over, and over, and over, and over again. And half JP is nearly the same as Plunge Spam, but you are weaving in the first half of your first normal before you jump. This is a single target DPS increase for a very minimal downtime on plunges. We're talking you lose like 3 or 4 frames per plunge. It's very useful for mob plus big guy situations, where you're fighting, say, a Mita Churl plus a bunch of Haley Churls, so you can get extra DPS on that big guy target. N1C JP is a bit different, where you're using your N1C before each plunge. You can cancel out of the charge fairly early, making it the highest single target consistent DPS option Xiao has when in ult. The visuals on the charge attack are also the only way to have a consistent visual indicator of when you can or cannot execute a high plunge, which is the final barrier to Xiao's highest DPS, and the cause of most of his mechanical skill requirements. See, the thing that lets Xiao reach Diluc vape levels of damage, and by Diluc vape levels we mean Diluc's DPS while he's vaping, we're not including the support's DPS in this particular instance, is the existence of his high plunge. Plunge damage has two components, those being the plunge itself, and then the landing impact. What we're focusing on here is the landing impact damage, which comes in low and high damage variants. Now what works so far as the theorycrafting community is aware is that you transition from low to high based on your fall distance slash time. And this is not a gradient. You either get low damage or you get high damage. This means in practice and in combat, there is a single frame difference where you will transition from low plunge damage to high plunge damage. This is what puts a hard threshold on Xiao's plunge DPS. Generally, a unit's actual DPS peaks at frame perfect inputs. This would normally mean you would want to act the first frame you can after any other particular action. However, with the threshold Xiao has on his plunges, you instead want to input a frame perfect input X number of frames after the jump. The issue with this is, if you happen to be too fast by one or two frames, Xiao's DPS heavily plummets compared to what it could have been. Shown in this graph here is Xiao's plunge spam DPS in motion value per second. It hosts a 21 frame window from frame perfect to 20 frames past frame perfect. You can see the peak is not at the start, but sits in towards the middle of the graph. The drop off, being one frame too fast in high plunging, is fairly significant, being approximately a 19% DPS loss. This does vary a bit with the different plunge combo options available, namely N-half JP and N1C JP, but it is a significant DPS loss regarding of which combo of plunge you use. What is useful to know is that going for high plunge is still generally worth it, as you have a 10 to 12 frame window to net a higher DPS value than just low plunge spamming. This is the reason why Xiao is generally considered inferior to vape Diluc. It's that to reach the Diluc numbers, you have to hit a very tight window with a potentially punishing DPS drop if you miss it by going too early. This is, in theory, a learnable timing, as the gap between the jump and plunge inputs should always remain the same. However, it's not easy to nail down in normal plunge spam, as there are no visual indicators. Luckily, the N1C JP combo does come with a visual indicator, which is about 0.7 to 1 Xiao in height between Xiao and the top of his charge attack claw. However, pairing this with landing a 9 frame perfect jump cancel out of N1C into the jump plunge, even with the visual indicator, hard to execute. Honestly, don't let that get you down, because even if you don't execute frame perfect, and who cares anyways, because I know I don't. With decent activation of high plunge being 5, 6, 7, 8 frames off, you still have a very sizable DPS that easily puts you 4th in DPS behind the 3 current kings and queens. Except you don't need reaction supports to reach it. If you don't use the proper reaction supports for Clear Diluc, then he winds up being 2nd place. If you're like me, and you don't care for vaping Diluc or Clear. Xiao is incredibly strong at what he does. Add to that the capabilities we currently have in his combos, in making him flexible in how he responds to combat situations, when outside his ultimate of course, and also take into consideration that his leap, when you let it play out and don't immediately plunge, enables you to make fairly decent directional movements per jump, enabling him to move around the battlefield whilst still having damage uptime. It's not something many characters can attest to having without heavily burning stamina to dash cancel. And that's a nice quality to have. I'm going to leave the spreadsheet I used for each of the combos in the description down below. They contain a table for all the combos over a range of frame totals, so you can get an idea and picture to see how the DPS is affected over time. And with that, I hope you all have an idea of what combos Xiao has, and where they are generally used. If not, there will be a small write-up in the description about each one, where you might use it, and when it might be best not to particularly use it. You can, again as I said, find that in the description. If you have any further questions about them beyond that, either leave me a comment down below, or join up on my Discord as always, and we will be able to best explain what exactly you need to know when you need to know it. Now, to provide a brief channel update before I go, I will probably not be covering Kaching in a video, as she has been out long enough that others have her covered. I would much rather use that lull in time to get more videos that I want to get out. These intended videos, in no particular order, are starting the Elemental video series, putting out my methodology on gacha unit recommendations, doing a Sacrificial versus Favonius video, another short video on the Widsith, why it's so good, and what effective uptime is, fancy title to be determined, and potentially even put out a call to action to you guys, the Cleaveful community, to help me make a resource for the rest of the Genshin Impact community at large. Specifically making a well-vetted frame count library for each and every character. Considering we don't actually have one yet, it would be extremely helpful both to me and to other members of the Genshin Impact community to know exactly what frames each character has, making it a lot easier to simulate team DPS in a variety of scenarios. And with that, as always, if you do have any questions, feel free to place them in the comments down below, and make sure as well to hit that subscribe button and ring the bell for the aforementioned future videos. I thank you all very much for watching, and I'll see you all again real soon.